Namaskaram, good afternoon. So today we celebrate 10 years of Navgati and 1 year of Aditya, which is India's first solar ferry and its successful service. So there is a strong reason why we are getting Professor C.K. Raju to start the proceedings. I'm not going through the list of his accomplishments, some of which are there in the flyer. But one thing he represents is original thinking and fighting against the odds. So he has shaken the very foundation of regular mathematics and physics as we know today. So at the end of this talk, like in our school, we have learned about a lot of stories of science and maths. Stories like Pythagoras, Euclid, and later on from Europe, stories of Copernicus, Galileo, Newton. But we have never questioned the basis of these stories or how the West is propagating such stories without any primary sources or without any evidence, right? So one thing we want to achieve at the end of this workshop, it's not to get a new story. It is for all of us to question when somebody comes with a story, whether it is valid. You have to question the assumption. That's the only thing we need to get out of this workshop. So Professor Raju will focus on two of the aspects among the lot of areas which he's working on. To get a glimpse of it, we have put some books of his. Two are there, which is published in India, hence it's relatively accessible. But the other three are just for reference, at least to give you a breadth and depth of his studies and research. Right? So today he will focus on calculus and probably touch upon the calendar. And now over to you, Professor Raju.
So I think I'll go up. So thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting me. And there are two reasons why I happily accepted the invitation. When I was in CDAC, that was a long, long time ago, 1980s, I thought that the supercomputer that we were building would be used for technological innovation. But people were awfully frightened at the thought of technological innovation. They were extremely frightened. So I remember there was somebody from the Indian Automotive Research Institute. He said, am I a fool that I will build my own engine? I'll import what is there from Mercedes and use it, that will sell. So I think that what you are doing, this technological innovation, I think this is something very good, and I would like to congratulate you on that, right? So that is one thing. And the second thing is that in so many years I've been working on this, nobody invited me to Kerala. Last time I was here in Cochin was when I was studying the traditional navigation. And that was 20 years ago. Now some part of my family was in Cochin. My uncle used to teach traditional law at the law college here long, long back. And he thought he was the expert on Samved. And so he recorded his rendering of the Samved at great expense those days. However, that is all in the past now. Last time I came, as I said, I was looking at the navigational problem and I discovered something. Looking at traditional navigation, I went to Lakshadweep and it turned out that it was not really traditional navigation, A, and B, Vasco da Gama, you remember 20 years ago was 1998, it was the 500th anniversary of Vasco da Gama. Some people wanted to celebrate it. And there was a huge storm and a ruckus, and finally they decided not to celebrate it. But they still had an Indo-Portuguese meeting, the Indian National Science Academy, and therefore I was involved in that. All right, so we have spent, how much time will I have? Okay, so the time is still the same, does not depend on the starting point, then it is perfectly all right. All right, so I would like to talk about, as the title says, calculus, the Kerala school and the teaching of mathematics today. And as Sandeep said, it is, I will touch on the calendar, he asked me to talk about the calendar, so I will begin from that. The remote is not working, will you fix it back please? All right. So we celebrate New Year. I was in Bell. I had a recording of it, but it is pretty horrible. I think I will not play it if people want to hear the way New Year is celebrated. But which New Year do we celebrate? That's the point. New Year 2018 is New Year based on the Christian calendar, the Gregorian calendar, which is a legacy of the British. Now, well, if it's a legacy, that's not a problem. Of course, we don't call it the Christian calendar. We call it the universal calendar. We speak of the Hindu calendar. We speak of the Islamic calendar. We never speak of the Christian calendar. Never mind, it was adopted. The Julian calendar was adopted some 1600 years ago by the First Nicene Council as the official Christian calendar. And it was used to fix the date of Easter, because Easter, at that time, Easter and not Christmas, was the main Christian festival. So there are several problems with the calendar. All right, it is unscientific and inferior to the Indian calendar. Why did we reject our Indian calendar? And we talk of science, what happened to our scientific temper when it comes to the calendar? In 1582, the Gregorian calendar reform that was done, it involved inputs from India, from Kochi in particular. And this is the important aspect, that it damages our economic interests, it damages our economy. I don't know why this pointer is not working. It's working, you can see it? Oh, I see, I'm not able to see it. Okay, it's too bright. Screen is too bright, yes. So it damages our economic interests. That's very important. How did we accept a calendar which damages our interests? Can't we look after our own interests? And it propagates all sorts of superstitions linked to church dogmas. So I think that we link to church politics, to be precise. Right? That's the last term. And a lot of it is discussed in my book, 11 Pictures of Time. So it's obviously unscientific. Let me just elaborate quickly. I don't want to spend too much time. Months are in complete disarray. 28 days for February, sometimes 29 days, 30 days, 31 days. It cannot keep track of the lunar cycle. Impossible. Month is supposed to represent the lunar cycle. And this is the case in the Indian calendar, where you use tithis. So 30 tithis always make a month. All right? Then the question is, how many days in a year? May I ask someone? How many days in a year? How much? 365. 365.25. Anybody else? That's the best you are able to do. This tells you what sort of education you get. Because the simple thing which was known to us from the 3rd century, you have forgotten as a result of colonial education. You are giving a wrong figure for something as basic as the duration of the year, of the tropical year to be precise. Okay, so this was the error in the Julian calendar, that it was 365.25, 365 and 1/4 to be precise. A very hopelessly erroneous figure, hopelessly erroneous even by the standards of 1500 years ago. And today you are restating it. So this error, why did it happen? It happened for a peculiar reason that you learnt it. This is what I'm saying, that under colonial influence, you learn the wrong calendar and you don't figure out what is wrong with it. Error arose because Greeks and Romans could not do fractions. They had no notation for fractions. They could not say the precise figure. They could not say 365.242. So they said 365 and 1/4. And that's a huge error in the calendar, because it leads to a one-day loss in a century. And that led to a major problem with navigation by the 16th century, which is why the Gregorian reform was done. All right. And this reform was done, actually it's called Gregorian reform. It was done by the Jesuit general, Christoph Clavius. And his student, Matteo Ricci, was in Cochin. And see, this is, I think, what we should talk of as evidence. This is a primary source. It is the handwritten letter of Matteo Ricci, which I got from the Jesuit archives. And they don't give you the documents so easily. All their documents are secret under lock and key, even from the time of 1582, because that's the time they tried to convert Akbar. They wanted to conquer India like that. So this handwritten letter, of course, he writes in I can't see the point. This Brahmane intelligence, he's talking about an intelligent Brahman. Or for chronicles or tempo, the methods of chronicling time, of timekeeping. And the other thing is Moiro Honorado, an honorable mood. So he's in Cochin, he's looking for an honorable mood or an intelligent Brahmin to tell him about Indian methods of chronicling time of the calendar. All right? And this is public, there are so many other things. The other part is that these Indian inputs which went were half digested by Europeans. Europeans were barbarians at that time. They didn't know how to navigate. Vasco da Gama came with the help of an Indian navigator. He could not cross the open sea, yet they teach you that he discovered India. There are millions of people living in India. Columbus discovered America, and then all the people who were originally there were killed, dead. That's genocide for you. But the point is it was half digested because Protestants rejected the reform for another 170 years. Newton died thinking he was a man of destiny because he was born on Christmas. So he, as you know, he wrote a seven-volume book on the Bible, correcting all the stuff that had been put into it by the church. He was a completely committed enemy of the church, but he thought he was a man of destiny because he was born on Christmas Day, according to a wrong calendar. So you think of his life, 80 years of his life, how he lived on the strength of an illusion. And of course, his work on the Bible still remains suppressed to this day, his history of the church. Okay, so then the Gregorian calendar damages our economic interest. We are not able to look at it. We don't even understand. We don't look at it. What has happened to us? This is what is called indoctrination. You start harming yourself. You don't think of your own interests. So why does it harm our economic interests? Indian economy, very obvious, still depends on agriculture. Still. Very much dependent on agriculture then. It is still dependent on agriculture. More than 50% are still into agriculture. Which depends on monsoon. As people used to say, well, the Indian economy is a gamble on the monsoon. Or the rainy season. There is no rainy season in the Gregorian calendar. There is one on the Indian calendar. You know, you have Savan and Bhadon and so on. Every child knows about it. But you don't have one here. So how do you know when it rains? You don't know. And therefore, it leads to the phenomena of fake delayed monsoon. I have been documenting it a little bit here and there, off and on, and nothing happened. Nobody is bothered about it, so I did nothing much. So this is what happened. You know, drought grips half the country. 276 of 524 met districts get deficient or scanty rainfall. This is Times of India. When I read this, I was laughing. Why was I laughing? Am I such a cruel person? No. I was laughing because the paper came a day late, and when I was reading it, it was raining cats and dogs outside. So there was a big problem, big mismatch. People were preparing for drought. Drought relief had been given in some cases, and ultimately you had to take care of flood relief. You remember that was the year Bombay got badly flooded. So the point is that monsoon was delayed, but it came on time on the Indian calendar. But we don't look at it. We don't care for it. I mean, at that time, I was in Bhopal. I wrote to the government. The principal advisor to the government was my vice chancellor. Nobody did anything. We can't do anything. So this is our state of affairs. Same thing happened in 2009. So you see this deficient rain. Scrambles to save Kharif, prays for Rabi. Monsoon washout. Drought almost certain. Look at that fellow, he is dead if it doesn't rain because it's rain dependent. And then you see this kind of thing, you know, they are marrying frogs, doing all sorts of things, even in this zone. And then what happened? Floods. Once more, you anticipate droughts on the strength of a wrong calendar, and then you get end up with floods. So this is what has been happening pretty regularly. Yamuna bank rupture looks imminent. You know? So the point is that what colonial education teaches you is uncritical imitation. As he said, the main point is not what you do, but how you do it. Why you believe what you believe? Why do you believe the year has 365.25 days? Because that is what you were taught in school. You never checked it. And you did not realize that this is an error which was corrected 500 years ago with inputs from Kochi by Europeans. So European education, Western education has put us back. It has put us behind the times. That's what has happened. I think I need something important. Yeah, may I have my bottle? Thank you very much. Okay. And if the master is critiqued, people will jump to save the master. And I said, like a loyal dog, but the point about a dog is, a dog's loyalty doesn't depend upon who the master is. Even if the master is a murderer, dog will remain loyal. All right, dog does not think about that. It just has this thing about loyalty and nothing else. So, the Gregorian calendar helps to spread church superstitions. For example, when we ask 2018 years counted from when, and typical answer will be birth of Christ. And obviously, Christ is not a surname for Jesus, and Jesus is a myth, not history. But if you write history only with dates using this, then you are stuck with that. You start believing it because you utter the lie so many times, you start believing Jesus is a real historical figure. Jesus is actually copied from Egyptian myths of, you see, Yesu, it's not Jesus, Yesu. Yesu from copied from Egyptian myths of Isi and Osir. So the zero point of the Christian calendar has nothing to do with the start of Christianity or the approximate start of Christianity. No historical records to that effect. It was retrospectively fixed 6 centuries later, 5.5 centuries later by Dionysius Exiguus in relation to the date of Easter. But your identity is tied to that myth. You cannot say how old you are. You cannot produce a passport without engaging with this myth. So it becomes a reality, which is what the church wants you to believe, that it's a historical event, something special, not a myth. And of course, there is ADBC superstition along with ABCD. That's what you're taught. It's impossible to read any Western history without ritualistically reciting AD, which means year of our Lord, or BC, which is before our Savior. So these are key church tenets. So what I want to summarize is that colonial education teaches us just one thing, the master and his ways are superior. And we uncritically abandoned something better because somebody told us a lie which we did not check, and we have stuck to it for so many centuries. It's a serious problem of indoctrination. So we abandoned our superior calendar for the inferior Gregorian calendar without noticing that the information went from us. Obviously, the Protestants couldn't do it for 170 years. Nobody in Europe could fix the duration of the tropical year, which is not a very difficult thing to do. All you have to do is to measure equinox precisely, which they could not do. There are so many things they could not do. And therefore, it took that long. That calendar damages our economic interests and promotes church interests by propagating church superstitions. So this is the summary. So there is my calendar, there is my video on the calendar. Take a look, there are more details in that. And of course, in my that book which is there, popular level book, Euclid and Jesus, this is the cover of the book. And you will wonder what has Euclid got to do with Jesus, because Euclid is what you read in math, and that's what I'm coming to. The question is, the thing which happened to the calendar, that you accepted something inferior, you accepted something superstitious, you accepted something erroneous, you gave up your own stuff without bothering to examine it, did the same thing happen with math? That's the question. And is it still happening? Because what is it that we are teaching? And Euclid is one of the prime myths that we teach in class 9. So this is the question. Did colonial education force upon us an inferior mathematics? Right? This is what we are talking about. And a Christianized math, a math which promotes certain superstitions. Now, I think somebody should, I'm saying the answer is yes, but I'm sure somebody should object to what I'm saying, because it is not my point that you should uncritically accept what I say. So you should challenge me. You should ask a question. What is this guy saying? Where is the religious belief in math? So everybody will ask that. Where is the religious belief in 1 plus 1 equal to 2? Why don't you ask that question? You should ask that question. Do you see any religious belief in 1 plus 1 equal to 2? You don't, no? Why am I saying this? Christianized math? Have I gone crazy?
Point is, it's a little harder to understand. The reason to give the example of the calendar was it's harder to understand what is happening in the case of math. So let me explain. Since you don't have the doubt, I have put it on your behalf. You should have the doubt. All right? Where is the religious belief in 1 plus 1 equal to 2? How can it spread religious superstitions? All right? Calendar was simple. So let me show that to you. Why is 1 plus 1 equal to 2? Question, not a rhetorical question. Why is 1 plus 1 equal to 2? I'm not asking a very difficult question, am I? Please don't be silent. I'm expecting a simple answer. Why is 1 plus 1 equal to 2? You've been taught like this. That's not good enough reason. You've been taught wrong, you have to question your teacher. If I say something wrong, you have to question me. All right. That's not a good enough answer. What you have been taught, you were shown pictures of apples and oranges. So one chair and one chair makes two chairs. That's what you learnt in kindergarten. What you learnt in kindergarten is what I call normal math. Because you're looking at chairs, chairs are accessible to the senses or whatever objects that you're talking about. It involves an empirical process of seeing something. This empirical process is not allowed in formal math. From 6th standard onwards, what you are taught is not normal math, you are taught formal math. And in formal math, the empirical is prohibited. It is not allowed. You can't say one chair and one chair I can see. No, any sensory input is inferior, declared inferior. Therefore, formal math prohibits it. You never asked, perhaps you never understood that formal math prohibits them. But this is the starting point of formal mathematics from class 6. I'll explain to you as I go along how this happens. So the natural question is, what is the right way to do 1 plus 1 equal to 2? And Bertrand Russell explained it, well, his book with Whitehead in South Africa just now, and all that the guy could say, you're saying Russell's book, it was actually Russell and Whitehead. So I said, that is not an issue. Russell and Whitehead, it needs 378 pages to prove 1 plus 1 equal to 2. And this is the 378th page. Do you understand one word in it? Does anybody in this country understand one sentence in this? Russell, Nobel Prize winner, great chap. So let's accept it. Let's believe what he said. Yeah? Anybody understands anything? So you can ask this question wherever you like. You can ask in IIT. You can ask in Indian Institute of Science. You can ask in Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. You won't get an answer. This is a simple matter. Russell is proving it only for integers. In South Africa, I challenged that guy to prove 1 plus 1 equal to 2 in formal real numbers. It'd probably take 1,000 pages. He could not do it. Nobody has done it as far as I know. Nobody would probably dare to do it. So, what is in those 378 pages? All metaphysics, all 100% metaphysics. And what is that metaphysics? It's a metaphysics of infinity. Because if I want to talk of integers, I must first say what are integers. But integers are infinitely many. So I get into a metaphysics of infinity. If I want to talk about real numbers, I'll get into all sorts of metaphysics of infinity. This is central to formal mathematics, a metaphysics of infinity. So you don't understand that metaphysics of infinity. You don't understand how it relates to church dogmas of eternity. Some of those dogmas are there in my book, 11 Pictures of Time. So from this position of ignorance, what do people do? You don't understand this, you don't understand that. You say it cannot be connected. Why not? How can formal math be connected with theology? Well, Russell was an agnostic. So you guess. Guess on that basis. Guess on the strength of total ignorance. Just because Russell was an agnostic. Yes, he was an agnostic, but how could he get over his entire indoctrination? You could not get over your indoctrination even about the duration of the tropical year after so many years. So he was a product of Cambridge. Cambridge is a church institution. He could not overcome his indoctrination. Nietzsche was totally against the church. He could not overcome his indoctrination. He fell victim to Augustine's trap. So this happens all the time. If you have an indoctrinated person, you can get over some part of it. Very difficult to get over all part. So it's a naive assumption which is not true. Now, the central part of colonial education is that it came to us through the church. The best colleges, science colleges today, are still church institutions, St. Stephen's College, St. Xavier's College, Loyola College, Madras, and so on. We did not ask, it's coming to us for science, why do we need church institutions for science? And the church education was the universities like Oxford, Cambridge, Bologna, Paris, and so on, Pisa, they were set up during the Crusades. Set up during the Crusades in order to produce missionaries. So the Crusades were military, well, they were militarily lost. And how do you produce a good missionary? You inculcate ignorance. If you don't know, how will you decide? What I told you about Russell, how will you decide? You have no means of deciding if you are ignorant. And therefore, what you will do is that, well, the other part is that you must not accept common sense. You must learn to reject common sense, and then you accept authority. Anything can be true on the strength of authority. This is primarily what school education teaches, and there is no point in going into too much detail of that. So you don't have the common sense to ask, why are 378 pages needed for 1 plus 1 equal to 2? Russell was talking nonsense. Why do you need that for such simple thing? You can't say that because you are afraid. Russell, great man. How can you say he's talking nonsense? That is where common sense comes in, right? You should at least ask those 378 pages, what value has it added to you? All your life you lived, you were not even aware of it. Did it make any difference to you? Did not make any difference. So it added no practical value at all. So if you live for so long, you can continue to live without those 378 pages. You don't need it at all. So it adds nil practical value. So this is a cartoon I drew in a grocer's shop. There is Russell. He's bought a dozen things for 74 whatever rupees. And he is calculating how much is 74 into 12 by adding 1 plus 1. And that's the grocer who's obviously very annoyed at how long it will take. So let's take a second example. This is 1 plus 1 equal to 2 is too complicated. Let's set it aside. Let's take something simple. 6th standard NCERT text. All right? 6th standard NCERT text, which most of you would have read. Am I right? Yes? Okay, so you have read it. What does it say? Real geometric points have no size. Is it right? That's what you learned. A geometric point has no size. Because it has no size, something gone wrong. Typo, please ignore it. That real geometric points are invisible because they have no size. Why are they invisible? That is where we come back to the problem of prohibition of the empirical. If you can see it, it is wrong. It is not mathematics. If you can see it, then what you see is a dot. It's not a geometric point because a geometric point must not be accessible to the senses. If it is accessible to the senses, it's wrong. So incidentally, you have said that all systems of Indian philosophy are hopeless because all of them accept empirical proof, as does science, as does Islam. All of them are out. They accept empirical proof as the first means of proof. All of them, Nyaya Vaisheshik, Sankhya Yoga, Advaita Vedanta, well, also Buddhist, Jain, Charvak, and so on. That's the one means of proof on which everybody is agreed. Maybe fallible, but if I can see the chair, it exists. The first means of proof. You reject it. You should not see it, then you know it is true. How do you know? So, you have a bias, and the idea that if it cannot be perceived, then it is the right thing. How do you know it exists? Because if you can't see it, there are small things like an electron, you may not see it, but you can infer its existence. If you have an electron moving somewhere, you have a bubble chamber track, you are able to infer its existence. So if you can't see it and also cannot infer its existence, how do you know it's real? It is not real. According to all these systems of philosophy, it's not real. But your school text teaches, this is the real thing. And how do children understand what is an invisible point? Does it have two horns? Does it have four horns? Where is it located? How do you find where it is located? You can't see it. So this is very simple common sense. This is something that all of you have studied. Nobody objected to it for so many centuries. The geometric points are invisible. We didn't object to it after independence, that you study this stuff. That this text which was prescribed in Cambridge does that. And we are reading it because Cambridge is great.
So according to me, invisible points are like the emperor's new clothes. They don't exist. It's a delusion, pure delusion. So that's the emperor's new clothes. I suppose all of you know the story. A very fine thing, see, beautiful thing, but it does not exist. He thinks he's wearing a beautiful dress, but he's not wearing anything.